Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Amen? So we're here this morning not to be entertained, but to, and not to be just encouraged, but to encourage. So by that, I want you to sing this morning praises to our God. I don't care how off key you sing. And you folks that sing professionally and have had some training, tough. Because the word does not say sing in tune. It says make a joyful noise. So let's make some noise this morning. Okay? Because when noise comes and praise comes, the enemy has to go. Amen? Father, right now in the name of Jesus, as we come before you, we come before you praising you this morning. Taking authority over the enemy this morning. Lord, taking a stand against the enemy. And Lord, we begin to praise you and we begin to thank you and we begin to glorify you. We begin to honor you. And Lord, in all things, let your presence reign over this place this morning. Let your power encourage us this morning like a mighty rushing wind. Lord, right now, in Jesus' name, open up the windows of heaven in this place that we might be encouraged, that we might praise you, and we give you thanks and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Mary, would you come this morning?
This is Hebrews 11:1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Moreover, belief is the confidence of things looked forward to, the proof of things not yet beheld.
Amen. Amen.
Stay. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Pastor's talking about everybody being in a battle, and sometimes I feel like I unleashed that on this. But stood up here a few weeks ago and said I was going to sing that song, Goodness of God, until Satan loved it. And we're going to sing it again today because he needs to learn to love it. I found out earlier this week that I lost another job. And a contract ran out. And out in the far side of the house, I heard this little laugh when I got the call. And I was like, we'll sing that song again Sunday just to show you I can. So I've been battled hard this week. I have my vehicles down. It's just one thing right after another. But God is good and he provides and I have no worries. I'm just truly not worried this time. So let's just all sing today. Go ahead, Darren. You are not alone if you are lonely when you feel afraid. You're not the only, we are all the same, in need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the
the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, who were torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For this is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
It's a little warm up here today.
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? Do you know that all the dark can't from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priests to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? of all blessing and honor and glory. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is, he is. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He is, he is. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and the darkest night. You were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness
of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. And every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. The goodness of God. Hallelujah. All the way my Savior leads me. Who have I to ask beside? How could I doubt his tender mercy? Who through life has been my guide? All the way my Savior leads me. Cheers each winding path I tread. Who gives me grace for every trial? Feeds me with the living bread. You lead me and keep me from falling. You close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow me. All the way my Savior leads me. Know the fullness of his love. Oh, the sureness of his promise. In the triumph of his blood. When my spirit clothed immortal wings its flight to realms of day. This my song through endless ages. Jesus led me all the way. Jesus led me all the way. And keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow. And surely your goodness and mercy will follow me. Will follow me. All the way my Savior leads me. all the way my Savior leads me.
Pastor.
Hallelujah. You are King of Kings, the Lord of Lords this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are not under the authority of the enemy, but we are, Lord, under the authority of the mighty hand of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I mean, oh, God's good.
Amen.
Hallelujah, I am so excited about what he's doing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bill and Bob, if you would come this morning. I can see no better time to celebrate the communion experience than after a time of praise.
Amen.
After a time of moving in His presence, after a time of His glory. Ooh, and I feel the Holy Spirit here this morning wanting to do something mighty in His power. Wanting to have His presence
go forward this morning. Hallelujah. All the way, Lord, you lead us. Now, Lord, as we participate in this communion time, lead us. Lead us into this communion time, Lord, that we might say that we associate ourselves with you and we praise you for being God and being the one who is sufficient to meet every need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Please hold your portion until all have been served. Hallelujah, sola che io son dare le mani. Father, you are holy this morning. And Lord, we come to this time this morning to celebrate together the communion experience. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting in verse 23, says, For I received from the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we have a broken piece of bread in our hands this morning. And Lord, this broken piece of bread symbolizes the brokenness that you experienced for us, for our healing, whether it be physically, whether it be mentally, whether it be spiritually. Whatever our need is this morning, Father, you've already taken it on Calvary. And Father, as we celebrate and commemorate this time before you, we do it in remembrance or as a memorial unto you, and we celebrate, Father, the fact that you went through something so that we would not have to. And Lord, I thank you for the very grievous thing that you went through, that we might be free this morning. In Jesus' name, let's partake together. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Father, we have a cup. And Lord, we symbolize, Lord, through this cup, the blood that was shed. And we associate, Lord, ourselves with the blood of Jesus this morning that was shed for us, that we might be free, that we might be able to be forgiven, and Lord, that we can walk in your presence. And Father, right now we thank you, Lord, that that shed blood has brought a union between us and you. I thank you this morning that our sins are covered in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord, this morning that we have relationship with you through your blood in Jesus' name. Now, Father, right now, we do this in remembrance of you as a memorial to you, saying thank you for the blood that you shed for our salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's partake together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many of you know that the Lord's good? Hallelujah. I've heard a lot recently about different things that are going on. And I've heard a lot of folks in our fellowship, outside our fellowship and around the world, that are going through some very hard times. And I used to jokingly say about a hee-haw song, gloom, despair, and agony on me, deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all, gloom, despair, and agony on me. How many of you feel like that?
Amen.
But let me tell you something. The clouds will break forth that the sun might shine this morning. I believe God has given me a word for this place as we go into the armor of God and we look in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. And I know that's not in my notes right away, but if you can flip that up on your on the board, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, it says this. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. And then put on the whole armor of God, that you might stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, you that have my notes this morning, I may go and buy them, I may not go buy them. But I'm going to give you what God has given me. As I laid in bed, the Lord spoke to me three different nights this week about the things that are going on in the people of this church, where there is a consecrated attack of the enemy doing things to discourage and pull down and try to destroy what God wants to do. But I got a word for you, church. The wind of the Holy Spirit is about ready to blow. And get ready when it blows, because He's going to do some things that you cannot imagine. And Lord, I'm telling you right now, we need to understand that God is greater. Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 34 says this. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us all things?
All right. Yeah.
But look at 33. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died. And furthermore, is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession for us. Oh, Father, in the name of Jesus, as we come before you. As we come before you, Lord, right now, we give you praise and honor and glory. And Father, right now, let the Holy Spirit flow through this place. We know, Lord, that you're already here. We bind every influence of the enemy, everything that would try to disrupt and distract and destroy, and we loose the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name, that the enemy would not have a voice, but, Lord, you would have your voice spoken. Let me speak only what you would have me speak this morning. Let the Holy Spirit be in everything, Lord, that is done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God's got an army marching through the land. Deliverance is their song. There's healing in their hand. Everlasting joy and gladness in their heart. And in this army, I've got a part. That's what the chorus says. Have you got a part this morning? If you've got a part this morning, God is beginning to speak to His church and hand out our marching orders. Our marching orders. Jesus said, been crucified. And he'd been delivered up and rose again. Excuse me for a minute. And as he was delivered up and rose again, he told the disciples, go and tarry until I send you a comforter. Church, we are in a time where God is beginning to send His presence in a mighty way. And for the disciples, He said, listen, you go to that upper chamber. And most likely the same chamber that they received communion with Him the last time that He was there. Think about that. And He says, tarry until you are endued with power. In Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, or 2 through 4, it says this, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat on each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Amen. That experience happened over 2,000 years ago. But you ready for this one? God is getting ready to do that experience with the church again. I heard these words from the Lord three different times this week. The first time I say, okay, that, thank you, Lord, for that word. I appreciate that. Thank you, Lord. I'll hide it in my heart. The second time I heard these words, I went and said, thank you, Lord, and I prayed. And each time I went to the office, and you know what? I'm a little bit dumb, but I'm not stupid. And the third time, He spoke the same words to me. And I said, okay, Lord, there's something to this. And He said, say to the church, when you hear the sound of the wind, get ready to run. When you hear the sound of the wind, get ready to run. God is preparing His church for revival, and you need to get ready because pastors cannot be able to handle what's going to come. This church, God's going to use, I believe, to do great and mighty things in the Spirit. Some of you believe that. Well, if you believe it, God's going to do something. And if God's going to do something, you got to be a part of it. In this army, I have a part. When you hear the sound of the wind, and that wind is going to come what? Suddenly. Suddenly. It's not going to be something, oh, well, that's a nice wind, but it's going to blow you away. And I tell you right now, God is beginning to work on His wind to come blow us away. That's the reason why the devil's fighting you guys so hard. I know Pat's going through some physical problems, but God's going to bring him out. Donna's going through some problems. God's going to bring him out. Bill's going through some problems. God's going to bring him out. All these things. Deb's going through some problems. God's going to bring him out. You go, when you begin to see the problem, Look for the answer. Begin to believe that you're going to hear the sound of the wind. Get ready to run. I love this story. And part of this came through a prophet as he ministered some of this story. And I've been back to look at this story and read it again and go through some of it. And whoo, the Lord began to speak to me. Get ready to run. 1 Kings chapter 18, the last two verses of chapter 18. Now it happened in the meantime that the sky became black with clouds and wind, and there was a heavy rain. So Ahab rode away and went to Jezreel. Then the hand of the Lord came upon Elijah, and he girded up his loins and ran ahead of Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. Now let me tell you what happened. Because we're starting to see some, how many know we're starting to see some victories in our country? We're starting to see some victories. How many of you know the devil's getting defeated? A lot of things happening there. They're not coincidences. In Kings, this happens. 3.5 years, no rain. And Elijah goes to the prophets of Baal and says, let's see who's greater. Is Baal greater or is my God greater? And if you remember the story, the prophets of Baal came and they built their altar and they worshiped all night long and they cut themselves and they do everything they could to try to bring down fire on a chapped and broken land. You know, it's easy to have a fire when everything's dry. But they could not call down the fire. Then after they did that, Elijah said, my turn. And he said, I want to show you who God is. And he began to worship the Lord, built an altar, sacrificed on that altar. And then he said this is what's amazing. He says, listen, I realize it's dry. I just want to show you how good God is. He says, go get some water. Make a trough around this thing. Fill it with water. And he said, oh, that's not enough. Go get some more water and pour it over the sacrifice. And then he said, okay, stand back. See, I believe the water that is over the altar today is the things that God is beginning to prepare to change our nation. You're starting to see the water being poured down upon the altar, the prayers of His people. And soon, the Holy Spirit's going to step back and say, okay, God, have your way. And it's going to come down, and that altar is going to burn. And not only is that altar going to burn, but the prophets of Baal in this country and in this world are going to start to be consumed with the fire of the Holy Spirit. Either you're going to be with Him or you're going to be against Him. And if you're going to be against him, get ready to be a crispy critter. Woo! God's saying, get ready to run. First Kings 19, the next two verses. Look at this. And this is exactly what's going on in the church today. First Kings 19, 1 and 2, and Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. Also how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. Let me tell you something. The world is challenging God. Just like Jezebel. And he's saying to the people of God, listen to this. The world and the enemy is saying to you, he's saying, I am going to kill you. I am going to destroy you. And I am going to do all of this thing. And let me tell you something right now. He's planning on doing it. But there's one problem. The Holy Spirit. There's one problem in King's day, in Elijah's day, and that was God. And after he said the first two words to me, the second night he came and said this, gird up your loins. It's time to overtake the enemy. And I thought right then the Lord was speaking to me about going into the girding up your loins with the belt of truth. And I said, thank you, God, you're giving me a message. I did not know that that was part of this message this morning as I began to say. And it goes right along with the armor of God that we need to gird up our loins and fasten our seat belt. There is a safety issue with vehicles now that the law has determined that it's necessary to fasten our seatbelt for safety. God is saying, get ready, fasten your seatbelt for safety. The Holy Spirit is going to do something, and you got to have your seatbelt fastened because it's going to come so fast that it will knock your socks off if you don't fasten your seatbelt with the belt of truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you're not anchored in Jesus, if you're not moving in the presence of God, if you're not lifting up and praising God Almighty for what's going on, then you're going to get blown away. Simple as that. And as I begin to look at this, I begin to see something. Ephesians chapter 6:10. We started with this. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Be strong in the Lord. Start building yourself out. Start exercising your faith. I was so glad when Mary spoke what she did about Hebrews chapter 11 this morning. It's time that we exercise faith instead of doubt. You know, we have come to a point where we have caused ourselves to walk in fear and called it faith. I am afraid of what the devil is going to do. I am afraid of what's happening. I am bothered by all these things that are happening to me. But you know what? God said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might, the dunamis, the dynamite of His life. You know what? We need to begin to rely on God and let Him blow up our problems with the power of His might. He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. Do you believe that this morning? Okay, let's just take a moment. If you believe it, just put everything down and let's lift your hands and say to the Lord this, Father, I thank You that You are able to accomplish what concerns me today, and I give it to You for Your glory. Now blow it up in Jesus' name. Now leave it at the altar. Leave it at the altar. You've given it to Him. And let the fire come and consume it. Let it hit in a mighty, mighty, mighty way. I'm going to tell you, the influence of the enemy was so strong. Some of you seen me this morning. I could barely walk in this place. I knew it was an attack of the enemy. I stand here this morning in the power of God. I have not had to sit down once because why? God is greater and I'm walking in the power of His might. What can the enemy do to me when God be for me? Who can be against me? And then Daniel 11:32. Those who do, listen to this. Those who do wickedly against the covenant, He shall corrupt with flattery. But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out exploits. There are people in this world today that are patting themselves on the back. Oh, we got control. We've got everything under control. Hallelujah, you know. And they're moving everything in anti-God, anti-this, anti-presence, anti-Christian. But you know what? There is an anti. But for whatever anti you have, there is a God. There is a God. And they're flattering themselves all over the place how great they are, how powerful they are. But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out exploits. Your marching orders is to destroy the enemy. And the first thing that we need to do is come against His attack, but not stop there. The Lord said, if you stop with the fact that you come against the enemy's attacks in your life, if you stop there, you have not gone far enough because He'll come back. Well, what do I do? Listen to me very carefully. When you put on the whole armor of God, when you put on the belt of truth, and we'll get into that more specifically soon, when you put those things on, listen to me very carefully here. You need to stop the onslaught of the enemy, repel that thing, and then move forward and keep moving forward and keep moving forward and keep moving forward until you get to the gates of hell itself. Because my word says that the gates of hell shall not prevail against me. It's time to take back the land. It's time to move into promise. It's time to begin to do what God has ordained you to do and give you the margin and start doing exploits. Right. It's time to overtake the enemy. John chapter 12, 35, 36. Then Jesus said to them, "A little while longer, the light is with you. While you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going." How many of you have trouble in darkness at night? How many of you ever have gotten out of bed half asleep to go to the bathroom or to do whatever you're going to do, and immediately taken about five steps and went like this and stubbed your toe to the point where you could not hardly stand up? I've done it. I've been there. I've lived that life. And you who have not, thank God for you that you've never experienced that. Because there's nothing like a good toe throb in the middle of being half asleep. But let me tell you something. The church is asleep. In the church, because the adversary is trying to destroy so much, God is going to get that church up that's half asleep and wake them up, not in the nicest way. If you are sleeping, if you are complacent with God, you got a problem coming. And it's not the enemy. It's him. Because he is going to wake up the church. And he is going to cause you to understand that you need to put off your slumber and start to open up to his presence. And start to let him have his way in your life. See, Jesus said, "In a little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you." There's going to become a time when the darkness of the world is going to try to overtake the light of Christ. Are you going to let the darkness of the world overtake your light? While you have the light, believe in the light that you may become the sons of light. I watched a little documentary on medieval times. There's an interesting thing about medieval times with their torches. Their torches were their light. And sometimes for light, this is how evil it is, and understand this. I don't mean to be gross this morning, but sometimes what they would do to form light is they would take those who they had crucified or put on a stake, and they would douse them in oil, and they would light them on fire so it would light the light of the city. Listen to me very carefully. Believers who are complacent and who are struggling and will not put Jesus first are going to be part of those who are crucified and become light, set on fire. But let me tell you something. I don't want to be set on fire. I want to walk in the light. I want to walk in Jesus. I do not want to become a torch. I want to become a lighthouse. Amen. I want to walk in the light or through the light. I want to walk through the light He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. While you have the light, believe in the light. While you got Jesus, while you got the Holy Spirit, start to believe. Believe that you may become the sons of light. Boy, I'm going to tell you something. I pray that everyone in this church, everyone here within the sound of my voice, everyone that's listening to this recording, we get so full of the Holy Spirit that you begin to believe who God is, so that when you walk, you become light. And when you walk, they don't even see you. They see Jesus. Because that's the way it's going to have to happen. That's the way it's going to happen to combat the evil in this world. These things Jesus spoke and departed, and what's hidden from them. There's going to be a time that if we're not strong in the Lord, it'll seem like God's hidden from us. And even today, the enemy would say, God's hidden from you. But I would say, no, he's still here. I'm going to do one more scripture and then I'm going to end. I'm not going to do the second half of this morning. Because I just feel like the Lord's wanting to do something. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, these six verses. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day shouldn't overtake you as a thief or as a thief. Would you turn to somebody and say this? I am not in darkness.
I am not in darkness.
I am walking in the light. I will not let the enemy overtake me like a thief. Now you say it. Are you ready? Did you say that in faith? If you said it in faith, let it happen. I'm going to put my foot down. I am going to not walk in darkness. I'm going to walk in the light. And I will not let the enemy overtake me. I will stand. Jean gave a testimony the other night about something happened. She said she didn't even know what she was doing, but God knew. About several years ago, being very, very, very sick, and she heard the Lord say, stand, and she didn't know what it meant. So she physically stood up, walked down the corner, walked back. She was sick. Oh, she was sick. But the Lord was saying, uh-uh. You're doing what you know, and that's great, and that's a great thing. And you do what you know. If you don't have the whole concept of it, do the concept that you know. Because the Lord told her to stand. That word stand means stand up and say, I will not be overtaken by the enemy. I will not allow the enemy to have his way. I will allow the presence of God to move in me. Whew. You're not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you like a thief. This day, today. How many of you know that Satan's trying to overtake? Amen. But how many of you know that the Holy Spirit is here to fight with you and help you, and bringing the reinforcements of the angels and going to knock him on his feet? You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. Let us not sleep. Let us not slumber. Let us not be complacent as others do. You know, God, even back then, knew that there was going to be a complacent church. And there is. That he was going to need to wake up. How many of you ever heard the Lord speak to you and said, well, I'm not sure, even though you really knew he was sure, you knew who it was, but you said, I'm not sure. See, and tell me, don't tell me, well, that doesn't happen, because it happened in the Word. Check out the fleece. And you, if you don't understand it, look it up. Look up fleece. If it's dry, if it's wet. Lord, I'm just not sure if it's you. Even though I know it's you, I'm not sure it's you. Anybody use that excuse? I have. Because I did not want to do what God wants me to do. Let me not sleep. Let me not be complacent as others do. But let us watch and be sober. Let us be alert and ready. Alert and ready. Our marching orders, God has called us to be alert and ready. God is getting ready to deploy his troops all around this world. Get ready for deployment. And as I begin to look at that, for those who sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. I looked at that. Those who are complacent are complacent because they're half asleep. And God says, I'm about ready to wake them up. I heard an incident this morning of a young man the past 2 weeks have went out on the weekend and tied one on. And I know this church, as well as others, have bound that the enemy in him, but the enemy is coming against him because that young man has great things that he has to do for the kingdom of God. God's going about ready to wake him up. I almost feel sorry, but I don't feel sorry for him, because God's going to stub his toe real quick. God's going to cause him to wake up real quick. Because the night for him is about over, and God is going to bring his light. I'm ready for that. How many can agree with that? In Jesus' name. Some of you have family members, friends that you've been praying for a long time. Just stand back and let God do it. And when they stub their toe, don't laugh too hard, because God's going to begin to wake them up. What we have claimed for the kingdom of God is his. And you better understand that. We've claimed a lot of things for the kingdom of God. And I see a lot of people that we've claimed for the kingdom of God and indeed have anointing on their life that are moving in the wrong direction. Because the enemy says, as long as I got them, they cannot do destruction to me. But let me tell you something. God is about ready to take them out of the enemy's camp, turn them around, and move them towards the presence of God. I'm ready for it. Some of them have used the presence of God to get what they want, thinking they were manipulating God. God's about ready to call in the bills. But let each of us who are in the day be sober. Are you ready? Be sober. Be ready. Putting on the breastplate of faith and love. And as a helmet, the hope of salvation. Gird up your loins with truth, the belt of truth. Understand that Jesus is your way, your truth, and your life. Put on the breastplate of faith. Start using your faith. Well, great is my wife's faith, or great is my husband's faith, or great is the pastor's faith, or great is this saint's faith. No, let me tell you something. Great is your faith. And it's time that you begin to walk in faith. Amen. And quit relying on somebody else. God is about ready to kick out our spiritual crutches and make us walk. I wish I would have had one. I would have brought one this morning. How many of you have ever seen those walkers for babies? How many of you ever seen the walkers for babies? God is going to begin to say, it's time. It is time for you to understand a great thing. And what he is saying to us as a people is one thing. I am going to kick you out of your little infant walking thing, and I am going to cause you to stand on your own 2 feet. Amen. To walk, to stand. To stand against the enemy. I need to break for just a moment and pray. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we bind the enemy and we loose the Holy Spirit. And Lord, as you begin to teach us to walk and teach us to move forward and teach us to honor you, Lord, that you would kick out the crutches and that we would be able to see the enemy and stand in faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Put on the breastplate of faith and love. I have heard, and I have walked, and I have even said this. It's time for us to hate the sin but love the sinner. It's time for us to move in the presence of God. It is time for us to understand who God is. It is time for us to walk in faith and say to the mountains in our life, be removed. And it's also time for us to understand that the enemy is going to try everything within his power to destroy. It's the reason why faith and love are so important. And as a helmet, the hope of salvation. How many of you know Jesus this morning? How many of you need to know about the helmet of salvation that guards our head and our mind? The enemy is beginning to come against our minds to tell us that God can't when God can. The enemy wants to destroy. God wants to renew, restore, and do something mighty in salvation. The helmet, the covering of our mind. Romans 12, be renewed in your mind. In my mind. God wants to renew our mind. He wants to bring us into His presence and into His glory. The hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation. I'm going to say something to you that may be a little bit different, but I believe this. Salvation is not a one-time thing. It's a continual thing. God begins to peel off the outward layers. When you come to Him just as you are. And you come to Him with some bad parts. And God begins to peel off. How many of you know what I'm saying? And peel off, and peel off, and peel off. I feel like God's beginning to peel off some of us so that we can walk in the entirety of His salvation. He's not appointed us to wrath. Don't get mad at the person, get mad at the sin. I've heard the prophecy spoken, and I'm excited about it. And I'm believing it. And I'm praying that the prophet is right. But the prophet said this week, as I listened to him, said this, there is going to be a great revival coming soon in our homosexual community. And God is going to begin to work through our homosexual community and begin to pull off the sin of homosexuality and begin to take back the children that have been caught in that demonic attitude and begin to use them for the glory of God and the anointing that they have Him. You know, I know three people right now that are full of the anointing of God, that are walking in homosexuality, the sin of homosexuality. But I also know that God's a gracious God, and He's going to begin to do a work in the homosexual community. He's going to begin to do works in the communities that you don't think where He's going to do. You know why? He's taking the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. He's beginning to do a work. Begin to wait. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or we sleep, we should live together with Him. Folks, the time of napping is coming to an end. The time of revival is about ready to take place. God is going to wake His church up.
God is going to wake us up. But I'm going to tell you something. The enemy is going to try to come in and destroy and divide and conquer. But God is greater. How many of you know what I'm saying?
Amen.
Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Let's pray. Father, we bind the enemy right now in Jesus' name, and we loose the Holy Spirit. And Father, right now we just give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. Lord, we put on the belt of truth. We put on the belt of righteousness. We put on the breastplate of faith and the helmet of salvation. And Lord, begin to shod our feet with the gospel of peace, that we stand up against the wiles of the enemy. And Lord, we stand in your presence. And Father, as the old chorus says, may I stand, O Lord, in this holy place. May I be transformed and behold thy face. Father, right now, let us stand in the holy place. Let's be transformed so that we can behold your face. And Father, we just give you praise and we give you glory for doing that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. How many of you want to do that? Okay. Darren, I'm going to throw you a curve. There's a song in the thing says, Fill My Cup, Lord. Can you play that? It's down there. I invite you all to stand with me. We're going to ask God to fill our cups. Fill us with his presence. Fill us with his glory. Sing this song with me. As a
walk into a city I cannot see.
Not wrong one.
Through the depths of the valley where the sun can't reach.
Wrong one. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Hallelujah. It should be in from that wild worship. Hallelujah. Let's make this our prayer. Make this our statement of faith. I invite you to lift your hands.
Moon at the well, I was seeking for things I could not satisfy. And then I heard the Savior speaking, draw from my well, never shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirst of my soul. Bread of heaven, fill me till I want no more. Here's my cup, fill it up and make me whole.
So my brother, if the things this world gave you leave hunger that won't pass away, blessed Lord will come and save you.
breath.